Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. On this episode of Insight, we delve into the tricky world of navigating relationships in the age of consent.
For a really long time, I thought that sex was all a performance.
A lot of boys are therefore approaching it with this idea that women are always up for it.
I personally feel women are so privileged in this space where they can just point the finger at someone.
Consent is something that we've wanted to make an ongoing conversation throughout our relationship.
Do Australians approach sex differently?
Yes. When I heard the word root, who talks like this?
Shani, you were a stripper until your mid-20s. How did you view sex at that point in your life?
I was very confused about it. My mum was gay from the age of me being two. And then I sort of went through school being very confused about all of that stuff. And by the time I'd gotten to becoming a stripper, I was 17. My mum was losing her house and I thought, great way to make money, great way to save my family. Went with a fake ID and became an exotic dancer. At that time, I had no sex appeal about me at all. I didn't understand anything about intimacy. I was still a virgin. I was a virgin until I was 18, so I actually hadn't been in a situation where I had felt sexy.
Did stripping have an effect sort of on how you felt sexually?
Yeah. For a really long time, I thought that sex was all a performance. And that's because that's what I learned in the industry. The only time that I would be tipped was when I was really swinging my hair around and pretending to moan and pretending to touch myself and doing an act. And I think it took away from what reality was and what intimacy would be for me.
Did you grow up talking about sex at all?
I did have questions for my mum, and when she'd answer them with the knowledge she had, but obviously not wanting to confuse me because we hadn't talked about her being gay a lot. Yes, we did talk about it here and there, but it was quite an uncomfortable situation.
And what impact did that have on you as a child?
I started self-pleasuring very young. I got my period when I was 11, so lots of hormones and things were happening, and I felt really confused. I think the worst part about not talking about sex in the home probably caused a lot of shame, and yeah, it was a really hard time. I felt very different from all the other girls at school, and also my sister as well, yeah.
So, Hala, how was sex discussed in your home growing up?
So I'm the daughter of Indo-Fijian migrants, and when they moved here, they brought with them some deeply ingrained cultural values, and one of them was the conversation surrounding sex. And because it wasn't discussed at home, I didn't really feel comfortable discussing it with people my age. But it was actually through the books my parents had on the human body at home, because they're from the medical field, that I started reading up on everything I was learning about sexual health. And it was after that point where I started going onto the internet and, you know, Googling every kind of question I had. Those were my sources of information at that point. My parents never really delved into the conversation. I realised this was actually a widespread thing. It was something that was shared amongst the South Asian community. We just didn't have the space to talk about that.
You've been in a relationship for 2 years. How do you discuss sex with your boyfriend?
My boyfriend is also of South Asian descent, and we, when we started our relationship, kind of acknowledged when it came to sexual health, intimacy, sex, we wanted to make it a priority to discuss before, during and after. And consent is something that we've wanted to make an ongoing conversation throughout our relationship. It's something that is an ongoing thing we want to acknowledge as we progress through our relationship. Yeah.
Do you ask each other first if it's okay to do something sexually?
We are quite young, and obviously we're still exploring that side of our sexuality, what interests us. So anytime either of us want to discuss something that may be a new interest or something that we want to explore further in the bedroom, we kind of bring it up as soon as we think about it. It's not something that we kind of bottle until we're in the moment.
Amal, you're on the dating scene. How do you show someone you're interested in them?
Well, I tell them directly. This is not something which I used to do all the time. I come from India and I didn't have any dating experience at all. I was in an arranged marriage, so we separated in 3 months' time and it changed the whole world for me. So when I came here, I was trying to explore how things work here. And then I had to attend a dating coaching program to really understand the nuances of how dating works in Australia.
How can you gauge whether a woman is, say, interested in being touched or interested in having sex?
Body language is key because if you're meeting a stranger who you don't really know, you can't always talk to them about everything upfront. And again, this, I think of it from an attraction perspective. I can't just go on a date, sit next to somebody and say, hey, can I touch your leg? Can I touch your hair? Can I touch your shoulder? I can't just keep going thinking about this logically because it would be unattractive. So I kind of read the cues depending on how she is sitting, what she is saying. So I just read, I try to read all the signs that I possibly can.
How did you learn about sex in Australia?
For a long time, I've always been around people who I know. I come from India, so I've always stayed with Indians. And there was at this one point in time, I was like, hey, I need to explore what Australia is all about, how things work. I chose to go into a share house, which was run by an Aussie girl. And that is where everything started changing for me. Right on from week one, they started talking about sex very openly, and it was feeling very uncomfortable. And there were instances where things were a bit scary as well, when people were expressing their sexual desires to one another.
What would they say?
They would just say things like, I'm feeling really horny. Mm. I just want to fuck someone. And I'm like, oh, this is where I come from. It's not appropriate. That was a bit too much. And then we spent like a whole year and a half together in the house. And we shared pretty much everything about each other. So we pretty much know everything. And over the course of time, I learned that this is normalcy in Australia.
Natalie, you're French-Canadian and you grew up in Haiti. That's a former colony of France. Do Australians approach sex differently?
Well, yes. Definitely. What I have found is that the French-speaking people, the Haitian people that I've met and had sex with, they were open, had fun. When I came to Australia, what I have found, that was the first time, and I'm sorry about using this word, but when I heard the word root, that for me really was just like, what? I was, who talks like this? that was a bit of a shock. The experiences I had for myself were, it was quite mechanical and more sex act oriented. But I had to work on myself too, because it was a massive change in my lovemaking, I guess. And then, so then I had to really look back, where am I into this? And then that's when I started really, really internalizing everything and knowing myself better and taking responsibility for my experiences.
Mm. You've been married for 10 years.
Yes.
What does good sex feel like for you?
I'm very blessed. My husband, when we met, we were both coming out of relationships that were stagnant. And we were just bunny rabbits for the longest time ever. Sex was at every moment of the day, okay? Everywhere, loved it. And then you come out of that, you come out of that energy of full energy of sex being, you know, fun, but also an exercise almost. And you start knowing each other better. And I like to think that when we have sex, and I think my husband's very similar, I actually learned that person for the first time. So yes, we've been together for 13 years now, but when we have a real making love session, this is about actually hearing the body of the other person. It's about like it's the first time. I just love having those moments where I completely forget about the past and I just concentrate on this magnificent body in front of me. And that exchange, there's very little being said. There's mourning, but there's very little being said in our lovemaking sessions. But it's a total exchange and a flow.
Do those sessions include checking in with each other before or during sex?
No, I've always been very strong person, very passionate. And when I don't want something, it's pretty obvious. I don't need to say it. And I'm very good at reading people.
Amal, has relying on body language to determine your next move ever backfired?
Yeah. There was this one particular incident. There was this girl. We know each other for quite some time. She knows that I'm interested in her. So I've already communicated my interest in her previously. And there was this one fine day where we were just having a conversation and she was dressing up to go out. And the whole conversation started by she saying, "Hey, can you check if my dress is okay?" And she went and changed and she was trying many different dresses. And then we sorted that out. And then she said, "My hair is not okay. I'm going to do my hair." So we sat down next to each other, with her doing her hair and me having a conversation and flirtatious signs. I can see signs on her face. And then she was doing her hair. Her hair got tangled. So she was like, "Can you help me?" So all of these are signs for me that, like, the girl wants me to do something. So I helped her out. I touched her hair, obviously, because she said that. And then she felt my hands are hurting with too much hair tying. So I gave her a small massage, and she was like, "Wow, this is so good. You've got good hands." So every time you get a compliment from the other person, you feel like it's a positive response. And she gave all these signs. We had, like, arms around each other. I had my arms around her shoulders. And she was like, "We look really cute together." A month later, there was another different conversation happening in the house where she jumped in and she was like, "Yeah, he touched me inappropriately and I wasn't uncomfortable with it." And my initial reaction was really feeling angry because you were interested in the moment. And then again, you know me really well. We talk pretty often. We have talked a lot between those within the month as well. So you never brought this up before. And when there's something else going on, you want to bring that in. So I wasn't feeling really happy about it. But that's one instance where I feel like it's backfired.
Would talking about sex and asking for consent have been helpful in that situation?
I've thought long and hard about it. I'm not 100% sure, but I personally feel women are so privileged in this space where they can just point the finger at someone and it's the men who has to prove their innocence to other people. So,
Tanya, you're a clinical sexologist. Are we good at talking about sex?
I don't think so. But I think there's a lot of fear in the community about talking about sex, fear of being misunderstood, fear of not getting what you want, fear of being considered weird. And sex is often likened to be the same as talking about death, not very popular in some circles.
What are your thoughts on verbal consent versus relying on body language?
I'm a very strong advocate of trying, if we can, to do verbal consent. Body language changes, and I know, because I do a lot of trauma work as well, and I understand that our nervous systems can sometimes override and send us into fight or flight, which people recognise, and freeze and fawn, which people don't recognise so much. So fawning is where somebody pretends that everything's okay when actually inside their head they're like, "This is not okay, I don't want to do it, but I'm going to pretend that it's okay because I don't feel comfortable about saying no." And that's our nervous system overriding. That's not us making a decision. Our internal safety mechanism goes, "Burp, you need to pay attention to this. We're going to send you a coping mechanism for this situation."
Fran, a few years ago you met up with someone for some casual sex. Mm-hmm. Can you relate to that freeze or fawn response?
Yeah, absolutely. So we met up in agreement for casual sex, so I did consent to sex, but it turned to him forcibly choking me and forcing me to give him oral sex and holding my head down. So I did consent to sex, but I didn't consent to that physicality and to be assaulted. And part of that freeze and fawn was just wait until this is over. I'm a survivor of child sexual abuse, and sometimes that past trauma comes back. And sometimes it is just about thinking and disassociating in a way to, if you just stop protesting or don't protest, which I didn't, it will be over and then he can go and you can just get on with life.
Daniel, you're a consent educator and you work with young men. Can consent be communicated with body language?
I would make the distinction that I think if you're having a one-night stand, a hookup, you're probably going to have to use a lot more verbal consent. I think for your safety, for the other person's safety, and even to actually enjoy the experience, to know what's going on and what this other person likes. I think the difficulty is, if you are in more long-term relationships, there is a sense of saying, well, are we discerning things amongst us? Because this is familiar. We know each other. We've communicated things emotionally and mentally previously. And there could be a reliance on what is suggested through facial expressions and through touching, through perhaps even sounds that aren't necessarily verbal that confirm that this is something they would like. So I think there is both, and I would say err on the side of verbal, especially the less you know about this person, the less other forms of intimacy that you've cultivated.
How do you navigate consent in your private life?
I think for me, looking back on my previous sexual relationships, there was a lot of conversations before we were sexually active. So for me, I really value being emotionally and mentally intimate with somebody. I want to know lots about them. I want to feel safe with them. And I would hope that they would feel safe with me, that they can trust me. And so for me, whilst I think sex is a beautiful, profound, wonderful experience, for me, what makes it so is having that intimacy beforehand. And so there's a lot that's discussed and shared in before you're even in that scenario. So that for me is what then can make a sexual experience, I think, a lot more satisfying and hopefully a lot more mutually enjoyable.
Sarah, you've experienced sexual violence. How do you feel about body language when it comes to consent?
Verbal consent is key, the less you know a person. I understand that a lot of people think that maybe that ruins the mood, but for me and the people close to me, I think asking for consent can be really sexy, even if it's just for the fact that it shows that someone's educated, which I find stimulating. And if we need to overcorrect and make sure everything's verbal all the time to get to a point where we fix this empathy deficit when it comes to reading other people's body language, then that's what we have to do, whether it's unsexy or not.
Do you ask your partner for consent too?
Absolutely.
Goes both ways?
Absolutely.
Natalie, have you had sex when you didn't want to?
Yeah, there's two type. I spent this evening with this guy, fantastic, very sexual, excellent. But then he ended up with someone else. In the morning, we were staying at the same place. He came into the bathroom and forced himself on me. Now, I'm a very strong and passionate person. The night before, I gave all the indication I wanted the sex. I was full blast wanting that guy. And then when he went off with another woman, then that was finished for me. So in the morning when that happens, I said no, but then he forced himself on me and I just let him, I just did what I can to make him finish as soon as possible so he can get out of the bathroom. So that was one thing. But I also have sex sometimes when I don't want to with my husband and before my husband. And it's not rape, it's not forcing themselves on me. It's me, I'm not there. But then I let my body being taken. It's a masturbation for them. They masturbate themselves with my body. And I have let that happen in the past, yes. Mm.
So is having sex when you're not in the mood the same as having sex without consent?
It is different for me.
Mm.
I absolutely love sex. I'm sorry, I just love sex. It's something that's, I just love it. When I'm not in the mood, that doesn't mean I don't love it. And there is a part of me that I'm not saying enjoying it, but that is okay with that.
Have you ever pushed to have sex when the other person wasn't in the mood?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. And that's part of me taking my responsibility about sex. I have pushed myself on men when they didn't want to. Mm. And that pretty much, looking back now, it's like, wow, okay. That's not on. Mm. Yeah.
Tanya, what does consent look like in the moment?
If you can, and check in with yourself, like, do I want to do this? You might have agreed to it earlier, but do I want to do this now? I don't think it's asking for every move, can I touch here, may I do this, is this okay? That would get very tedious for everybody. But I think it's checking, like, how are we going? Are you having fun? Is this okay? Would you mind if we did this now? That kind of checking in, I think, leads to ongoing consent.
We are very entitled women. We're entitled to change our mind all the time. We're entitled to not know what we're doing. We're entitled to all kind of things in our mind.
I think there's a myth that men should know what to do, when to do it, and it causes a lot of anxiety for men.
Next week on Insight, what does it mean to be a man today?
I see myself as inferior to my partner because I don't earn as much as she does.
Everyone looks at masculinity as toxic masculinity. There's no, like, positive masculinity.
Violence and aggression helps men leave genes in the next generation.
You think it's heading down a road to misogyny?
I think it's already there.
To be tied up, you need to have a lot of trust. Trust in the person that's tying you and trust in yourself. Shibari, because it's a metaphor for a lot of our experiences. We're all bound up by things that influence us, and sometimes we don't even see the bindings that hold us. I become hyper aware, so the sheen of sweat, the pulse, everything else disappears, which is an incredible connection with somebody. My name is Eleni Diviak. I am a female dominant. I've spent the last 20 plus years getting down and dirty with the BDSM community. In BDSM, if you don't have consent, it could be a criminal thing. Even spanking is assault if you don't have consent. That's why consent is the absolute line between whether something is okay or not okay. Accidental consent violations can happen. And how that is navigated can often make the difference between somebody becoming a victim or learning how to establish boundaries, learning what their limits are. Because with limits of behaviour and what you want done to you, often you don't know until you've stepped over it. Your most intimate experiences are when you become vulnerable. There's a connection that forms with that vulnerability. This is a great way of letting go and releasing.
Tanya, what can mainstream society learn about consent from the BDSM or kink community?
A hell of a lot, actually. What Eleni was talking about there was the importance of establishing what's going to happen and what's not going to happen. And also, I think, you know, BDSM folks and sex workers are the cutting edge folks around consent because they have to speak about things for their safety.
Why are people in these communities better at talking about sex?
They have to do it because some of the things that they're doing could be dangerous. You can tie ropes, for example, in the wrong spot and cut off people's circulation. You could cause pain in parts of their body that you didn't know because you didn't know they had some sort of condition. There are lots of BDSM activities, spanking or other sort of more pain-inducing activities that people might think that they're really like, yeah, I'm big and tough and I can take this, but maybe they can't. And I think with BDSM play, often people get into euphoric states, so it's very difficult to ask for things in the moment. It's very important that you negotiate up front because you can go into a subspace, a bit of a trance-like space. I think that clip really showed it well, or a bit of a high doing what you're doing.
Outside of that community, how important is it to talk about sex if you're trying something new?
Very important, because how do you know how it works? I often get clients coming in saying, well, I tried this and it didn't go very well, and I've asked how they learnt about it. Anal sex is a good one because people look at porn and go, great, I can just do this to my partner without checking in with them because I saw it on the porn and it looked hot. But they don't understand how bodies work, what needs to happen, how much time is there, preparation, all that sort of stuff. So it's really important for you to not only understand your own body, but the people who you're playing with's body and their mind around things. Like, things can look really good on paper or when you're talking dirty to each other on the phone, but when it comes to rolling it out, it may be very, very different.
Fran, you experienced rough sex you didn't consent to. He didn't ask and you didn't say no. Would you have felt differently if he'd talked to you about it first?
Possibly. Not with that person necessarily, but I have had an experience where, again, it was agreed upon casual sex, but the person was very open and they started a conversation about consent, what our limits were, what we liked, what we didn't like. I'd only ever been in one adult relationship my whole life, so that was really helpful to me. And the fact that he prompted that conversation with me. And so the sex may have been similar, but it was very different because we had those conversations before, during, and also after to check in.
Do you think the man you had the negative experience with has any idea that you felt violated?
I don't think he's thought about it at all. And I don't think, even if I explained it to him, he necessarily would think he'd done anything wrong at all. And I don't think my story, sadly, is rare either. I think so many people would have an experience similar to mine, or in some vein similar.
Daniel, when you're teaching young men about consent, what are some of the common themes that come up?
Boys are being conditioned to assume that no doesn't actually mean no, that girls are up for sex all the time, because that is how they're fundamentally learning about sex and sexuality, through pornography. And so if that becomes part of their sexual template, they don't think that they need to ask for the act itself, or perhaps what happens within a sexual encounter. If, say, someone has consented to sex, but they may not have consented, as we've earlier heard, to perhaps violent acts or strangulation and things like that. So for me, it's about expanding this and asking boys to consider, well, what about mutuality? What about reciprocity? And for me, if desire isn't present, then you don't have consent. If desire is present and then that's communicated, then you have all of the above. And I think it's trying to get us to be people who would actually care about the other person's pleasure, their safety, their well-being, and have that actually be something that we want and need, and like especially want that, like we desire that from this other person.
How is that sort of education through porn changing expectations of sex?
The research says that boys who are consuming pornography are more likely to commit sexual violence and believe rape myths. And that's just the beginning of it. It's impacting what the academics call their sexual scripts, which is how you understand sex to occur between persons. And so a lot of boys are therefore approaching it with this idea that women are always up for it, that I don't need to do things that maybe make her feel safe or make her feel pleasure. I'm just here to get what I need to get from it.
Sam, how did you learn about sex as a teenager?
Sex education at school there was already a lack of sex education for a heteronormative audience. You know, like it wasn't holistic, it wasn't thorough, it didn't cover a lot of subjects. Like, I remember being in Year 7 and our PDHP teacher had put on the whiteboard sex, and it was, you know, a big circle around, it was a mind map. And it was just like that. The lesson, our education, was what we knew about sex. And that was sort of it. I didn't really learn anything about consent. And so I sort of, you know, moved to other forms of education, you know, going online and YouTube, porn, all that sort of stuff. And from there, it was learning really, it's just not what sex is. You know, it's a total opposite to what you think it might be. I felt that watching porn changed the way that I viewed sex. So when I grew up and I started having sex, you know, a lot of it was violent and aggressive and quite physical. And so I, you know, deep down I thought something was a bit weird, and, you know, you have that gut feeling that something's not right. You just can't put your finger on it. But I sort of expected my partner to be physical and violent. And it was just, I thought that that was normal. And I thought that was supposed to happen.
Did you ever fake enjoyment?
Of course, yeah, 100%. And, you know, I'm really glad fawning's been brought up tonight, because that's something I've experienced. And I think it's my way of thinking and how I've dealt with that in that moment was, you know, if I say yes is sometimes safer than saying no. And, you know, in queer sex, you know, there's often a power imbalance. You know, there's, you know, the typical submissive younger guy and then the older dominant daddy. So these people are bigger than you, stronger than you, like, they have all power in the room. Not just a physical power over you, but the space, the energy, the whole thing. And so, you know, when I'm in that position of something that I'm not comfortable with and I feel that, you know, it might be a safety issue or something, like, it is sometimes safer to say yes than it is to say no. So, yeah, I would agree with that.
So would you say you consented to what happened in those moments?
Look, that's tricky. Even prior to, you know, being sexually assaulted, you know, I was clear about what I was okay with, you know, here and there, like, as I was getting older. But, you know, I did consent to sex, but, you know, I didn't consent to being treated the way that I was, you know?
Shani, what was your understanding of consent as a young adult?
I don't even know if I had any or even thought about it. I, for one, have had intimacy with a male that, you know, I was scared to be like, I didn't want to kill the mood. Can you put a condom on? How do you ask? How do we ask? Why don't we know how to ask that? And so always felt like, well, it's on me. You didn't say no, so therefore it's not his fault. I have many, I can't even count on my hands how many times that's happened to me. And that is, I'm a very confident person. I am very outspoken. I'm not scared to say what I'm thinking. But in those moments when the energy feels really masculine and controlled, I absolutely feel like I'm going to kill the buzz. Therefore, I've not said, you know, can you put a condom on? Or no, that's, we're not having sex unless you put a condom on.
Mm. Tanya, does our culture encourage a sense of male entitlement when it comes to sex?
Yes, I think we encourage men to seek sex. We live in a world that's not very fair to people. And in that world, we encourage men to seek out and get sex. And they feel like it's their right because we tell them that it is. They're getting it from all angles of community. Your parents might not be saying that, but you can see it in the porn, as has been pointed out. You can see it in movies. Mm. How many romantic comedies have you seen where the heroine starts as a kind of dowdy librarian who says no thank you to the strapping handsome man who wears her down over the film until she agrees, and then all of a sudden she becomes ravishingly beautiful. It's really interesting seeing that. So I want to encourage young men who are saying, I don't want to feel uncomfortable, to get used to feeling uncomfortable, because we need everybody
equal
to join that conversation. Yeah. Mm.
I would like to add also that we as mothers, we have a damn responsibility to those yes. young men, because we are their first contact with sexuality in the first place. Mm. But we are also their first contact with the other sex. And here we are, you know, it's beautiful that men can be there for other men, but we start them. Mm. And for me, that's a massive responsibility.
Mm. Yeah.
Shani, do women play a role in that as well?
Absolutely. I think that lots of people will disagree with what I might say. I have participated in everything that has happened to me. Have I said I've participated in getting to the situation, but I've not wanted to participate in some of the things that have happened?
What does that look like?
Fake orgasms. I say this all the time. I think if you can fake something as a woman, as natural as pleasure, you can fake anything in your life, and that's quite scary because you're completely out of control with what you allow into your world, your life, your vagina. and that's scary.
David, you've been single most of your life. Have you ever been accused of being entitled?
It happens all the time. The moment I speak of the disappointment I feel, I'm a very, very crushingly lonely man, and the difficulties that I've had in meeting women over the years, any time I speak of it, there's this knee-jerk response that I get from all of my friends, and this response is automatically, well, you're not entitled to a woman's affections, and I have a problem with that. It doesn't make any sense. It's an illogical equation, because, and I've always used the example of a buying a lottery ticket. I want to win a prize. I want to win the affection of a woman, But at no point in that process am I feeling entitled to that or obliging that woman to give that to me. Mm. But that doesn't stop the accusations from coming forth.
Why do you think you're still single?
I grew up in a country town with a very sort of old-fashioned mother and father, and it was not something that was talked about in terms of consent or any sort of progressive or feminist rhetoric. It was just when my father sat me down and taught me, don't assume that because a girl's being nice to you that she likes you like that, don't speak disrespectfully to or about women, all of these were not about feminist ideals or about consent or progressivism. It was about manners and respect and courtesy. And it was just very sort of good old-fashioned ideals that I was being taught. And having that from like 10, 11 years of age, being, you know, reasonably introverted, being a big guy who triggers people literally just by being there. I've been told point blank to my face that I trigger people, and I quote, just by being in the room.
That they see you as a threat?
Instantly as a threat. And I'm so aware of that. I walked into an elevator and there was a woman on her own in the elevator, and I just, my eyes went straight to the floor. I just didn't want to put her in a position of feeling threatened by me because I am a big guy and I do, you know, I do represent a threat without even having to try.
How do you feel about some of the dialogue around a lot of women sort of like the man to make the first move, for example? Have you experienced sort of a confusion around that space?
Oh, yeah. Having had experiences of walking up to a woman and saying, hey, how you going? Or making eyes at them from across the room and them freaking out, however mildly they might, or walking away and saying, yeah, thanks, bye, I'm going to talk to my friends now. At a certain point, I'm just like, well, you know what, I stand here with my drink in my hand and try and look as benign as possible and hopefully they'll come to me, and they never do. Mm. And then, you know, they might be flirting outrageously with me, but I'm not going to assume that that's an overture to something else. And unless they make it clear that that is an overture to something else, nothing's going to happen. Mm. So and the sum total of all of that is I've spent 34 of the last 38 years completely alone, you know.
Amal, is it hard to know what women want?
Yeah. We talk about men being privileged, and I firmly believe that it's just the top 30% of men who feel privileged and who gets all the girls. And let's say, for instance, for me to date someone, I can't just put up the pictures that I took on the phone on Tinder or Bumble and then expect them to like me and me having a connection with them or going out on dates and stuff. So I need to go through a whole series of steps, like getting a stylist to do my styling and then go to a photo shoot and then use the photos from the photo shoot to get to a place where you can at least get matches, right? So the reason why I feel like in the dating scene, women are a little bit more privileged is because I have had instances of women putting just a picture of a carpet and getting like 1,000 matches. So women get a chance to choose who they want to be with. There are men who I know, especially from different backgrounds, who look really good, look good looking, handsome, but just because they are not able to go and express themselves to someone and to tell somebody that they like them, they've been single for a long time.
Natalie, can women send mixed signals when it comes to sex?
Most definitely. We are so confused. We don't understand sometimes, and I say we, I'll talk for myself, but sometimes we're so not in contact with who we are that we will send out some kind of message that's completely confused to a man when we don't even know what we actually want. We don't even have an intention behind what we're sending to that guy. So that's very confusing, I believe, for a man.
Could that be seen as a sense of entitlement?
From women? Mm. Oh, definitely for me, yeah. We are very entitled women. We're entitled to change our mind all the time. We're entitled to not know what we're doing. We're entitled to all kinds of things in our mind. And when we sit down with ourselves and we start looking at all that and taking responsibility, then we start realizing that there's some stuff that we need to clear up.
I think there's a prevailing myth out there that men should know what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. And it causes a lot of anxiety for men.
Natalie, what does the word consent sound like to you?
Consent for me is a bit legal.
For me, I think it's about finding consent in your own language and how you are able to communicate that. And I think it comes down to a matter of respect.
Natalie, what does the word consent sound like to you?
Consent for me is a bit legal. It's a word that implies, let's stop here, let's look at this logically. I totally agree with asking people what they want or what they don't want or stuff like that, but putting the word consent on it makes me a bit, it's something that flows.
So Hela, how about you?
I agree, there's like a logical and kind of legal connotation to the word consent. But for me, I think it's about finding consent in your own language and how you are able to communicate that, and also taking the time out to learn about how your partner communicates that. And I think it comes down to a matter of respect. And whilst I was introduced to consent as a university module that was mandatory, I still realised that there was ways that I knew about consent but didn't realise it was termed as consent.
Daniel, are we comfortable with the word consent?
I think we're rapidly using it a lot. I think that's probably more my issue with it, is how narrow it is. I think consent is essential. It's a no-brainer. It's the absolute bare minimum, right? But that's why, for me, I want to put an emphasis on things like mutuality, reciprocity and desire, and this emotional intuition that you can cultivate with another person. Because I think if you have all that, if you have intimacy and you have cultivated this shared understanding in a relationship, then consent will take care of itself.
Mm-hmm. Natalie, have your views on sex changed over the years?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I was a late bloomer because I had a very strict upbringing. And when I started to have sex, I was a people pleaser. So I needed to understand the man so I can give him as much pleasure as I can. And I enjoyed it. Now I've found that we actually don't have sex. We're making love. Mm. And making love does not always mean touching physically. And it's a complete different dynamic, and I learn every day with that.
What is sex like for you now in your 50s?
Yeah, listen, we're not bunny rabbits anymore. But we might have sex, I don't know, make love maybe once a week, but that moment can take hours, and it's so profound. Yeah. Mm. So I'd rather have the quality of that than the quantity of the workout I used to do.
Fran, how do you and your long-term partner navigate sex and consent?
We had discussions early on. He knows my experiences, my trauma, so he's very aware if there's days where I'm saying, or through body language, I don't even want you near me, I don't want you to touch me, he's okay with that because he understands. Mm-hmm. And having conversations, and not just having it, but continuing to have it, because people can change in a relationship, your ideas can change and what you want, and just having that discussion and keep having it.
Tanya, can consent be taken for granted in long-term relationships?
Yep, definitely it can, because if we assume that consent is the same as when we first met, but we are together for many, many years, that doesn't take into account a lot of things, like bodies changing, like just stresses on us, buying houses, having jobs, having babies, childcare, all sorts of things can impact our libidos. So assuming that sex is going to be the same, or activities that we liked last year, 10 years ago, or yesterday are okay today, that can be very fraught. So I meet a lot of people who are tolerating sex, and I think there's a lot of talk out there about women don't like sex, and I think that's incorrect, and they've missed out one word. Women don't like bad sex.
Can it be harder to talk about consent in those established relationships?
I think so. I often give clients a little game called the 3-minute game, where you're encouraged to ask each other for the type of touch that you would like to receive or that you would like to give to your partner. And people freeze after like 20 years. And I often say, you know, let's do this with all your clothes on, just touch for pleasure, nothing too sexy. Like, would you like a stroke on the arm? Would you like your hair stroked? And it's really confronting for folks to A, work out what they want, which really denotes to me that consent is an inside job, and B, vocalise that. There's such a vulnerability in asking for what you want. But I think every time you want to have sex with someone, quick check in. Hey, what are you up for? Are we doing this, you know? Have we got half an hour? Have we got 2 hours? You know, is one or none of us going to have an orgasm? Who's got a sore back or sore knees? So I just went to the hairdresser. Don't mess up my hair today. Tomorrow you can pull my hair and say giddy up, but not today, right? So every day will be different. And that quick 1-minute chat can really make the difference between a lot of pleasure.
Sahela, growing up, your family didn't talk about sex. Have your feelings about it changed?
Definitely. I've become quite sex positive in a way. I think the unfamiliarity I had with it growing up made me more curious to figure out what was the right information behind what sex is and also what it meant for me. For me, in my relationship, it's quite deeply emotional. And I think getting into consent as well, consent can add to the chemistry. So even though I'm still figuring out what sex and consent really is, I'm more than open to figuring that out in a way that I feel like I'm comfortable with everything that I'm doing. And at the end of the day, it's just figuring out, like, I'm equally as important during sex as my partner is. And so for me, I feel that it's something I'm going to continue developing my relationship with. And it's something that I should also be okay with developing my relationship with. I'm still young. I'm still trying to figure out who I am. And sex is also part of that journey.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Tanya, should we be talking about pleasure as much as we talk about consent?
Oh, my goodness, yes. And understanding how our bodies work, what pleasure is, what needs to happen in terms of arousal, makes a huge difference in how people experience sex and connection and their own bodies. So I'll always be encouraging folks to explore on their own, to find out what feels good, to practice talking about it because it is scary. But asking for what you want and getting it and feeling safe about that makes things absolutely phenomenal in the bedroom.
Sam, how do you know your partner's enjoying sex?
Well, I suppose it goes back to asking them. If I have had that conversation with my partner prior to having sex, you know, what I'm comfortable with, what they're comfortable with, what makes either of us happy, during that you can continue to ask, is this something that you're still okay with? And I'm really glad that it's been spoken about, you know, whose buzz is it killing if you ask, you know, if it's okay? I think it makes it better because I'm thinking, I'm enjoying this, you're enjoying this, let's keep it going, you know? Like, it shouldn't be something that shouldn't be said. You know, you should be having that conversation, and I think, yeah.
Amal, what do you think makes a good lover?
The most important thing is people really know how everyone else's, how the partner's body parts. And I feel men ask these questions, why does she take a long time? And women ask these questions, why does it come so quickly? And for men to really understand, once they understand how it works, and then they are happy to put in all the time and effort to make sure that she's aroused before they want to go in for penetration. That's the first basic thing people need to know, to understand something before they actually try to use it. I read it in an article, by the way. It explained how the clitoris is just the tip of the iceberg, and there's a whole system in there which all needs to be aroused for them to really feel pleasure. And then the most important thing is to understand from the partner what really turns them on. Again, everyone is different. Everyone is unique. Everyone's got their own different... For someone, just nibbling the ear would turn them on. For someone, you know, you really need to have sex for them to really feel the high.
Shani, sex wasn't something you always enjoyed. How did you discover pleasure in sex?
By exploring my own body. That didn't happen until after having a baby. I started exploring that. It was books I was reading. It was, you know, in movies. Like, I just became really curious and then started to explore my own body. But I think I'm having better sex now than ever, and I'm having better self-pleasure now than ever, because I think for a lot of women, it's accepting your body. So when I became friends with myself, I was good with what I liked. I found out that I wasn't the devil because I liked anal, or, you know, like, that's fine. That's what I like. I'm good with that. So when I became comfortable with myself, my sex life completely changed.
Mm. You have a six-year-old daughter.
I do, yeah.
What's your approach when you talk to her about sex?
It's got to be age appropriate, firstly, and reading my daughter. We have a really close bond, and we all like to think we can read our children, but, like, really tuning in and going, what's appropriate here, listening to the question. And also sometimes I don't have the answers. I'm a first-time mum, and I come from a space of not really talking about sex, having no knowledge about it. So this last 4 years, it's been a really important journey of self-discovering and finding out what I like and listening to other mums and other women and other parents, taking bits and pieces and curating what I think is appropriate and then passing on that knowledge.
Why is it important for you to be so open with your daughter?
I come from a long line of sexual abuse. I've been very aware of this and had deep conversations within myself that I am going to break the cycle, no matter what that takes.
Mm. Sam, you said your own school sex ed was pretty basic. How do you feel about the way consent is taught now?
I think the way that we talk about it now, especially in such a public space, the way we talk about it now is a step up from where we've been. It's good, but I think we can expand the conversation and we can learn more together. You know, we all have room to grow. And I think by really getting into it and talking about it, we can be even better, and we'll be saying the same thing I'm saying now 10 years from now, thinking, like, wow, I can't believe we used to think that way. And now we're holding.
You can come back to Insight 10 years.
10-year reunion.
We'll have a 10-year reunion.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, and thank you so much to you all for being here. I so appreciate your honest conversation in this room. Thank you too for joining us. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. See you next time.